Welcome to Castilleja's third annual Arts with a Heart performance. This is a very special year for Arts with a Heart, but more importantly, it is a very special year for Castilleja. During this, our centennial year, we have reached out to countries around the world to learn, to explore, and to give back. This evening, we will enjoy a series of pieces that take us through the decades of dance, with the fads and crazes of the various eras.
Tonight, we are honored to welcome a special guest, Mr. John Wood, CEO and founder of A Room to Read. All of the evening's proceeds will go to benefit this amazing charity that has worked to spread literacy and love of learning around the world. Room to Read operates under the belief that educating with children helps. Okay, I'm sorry. World change starts with educated children. By working with local communities to create a strong educational infrastructure, Room to Read has made great strides to try and eradicate the poverty that is an unfortunate consequence of this lack of educational opportunity.
John Wood, author of Leaving Microsoft to Change the World, founded Room to Read after a life-changing visit to the Himalayas. In 1998, he visited a school in Nepal and discovered that the startling lack of resources, especially books, was preventing children from receiving the education they truly desired. Overwhelmed by this injustice, Mr. Wood abandoned the corporate world and his job at Microsoft to found the nonprofit organization this evening's performance is benefiting.
His story is inspiring for the humanitarian and philanthropist in all of us, and hopefully many of you will follow in his footsteps to change the world in whatever way you can. And now, please join me in welcoming Mr. John Wood.
Good evening. Good evening. It's great to be here and to see a full house. And I just really want to start off by thanking all of you who've been part of this great fundraising event. We really appreciate you adopting Room to Read. And most importantly, in a way, adopting so many girls around the world who don't get the opportunity to have the most basic education, like these girls you see here in Nepal, who are in our Nepali scholarship program. This is a very happy day for me, because not only did I get to meet all these girls, but we presented them that day with their official Room to Read fleece jackets to survive the Nepalese winter. So it was a very, very special day. So thank you for all of you for helping us to reach these kids with the amazing gift of education and the self-sufficiency and the opportunity that only an education can provide to these kids throughout the developing world who are quite often, unfortunately, left behind. The core belief of Room to Read is exactly as stated. These six words, world change starts with educated children. We all believe that if you want to change the world, there's really no better place to start than by giving kids a really high quality education. All of us in our lives have benefited from having a great education, and this is just a fantastic way to pay it forward and to feel that we're doing something to help humanity and especially help these kids to move forward. The goal of Room to Read is a tad bit ambitious, but we live in Silicon Valley, a land where nobody is afraid to state a very big goal and then to go after it. In our case of Room to Read, our goal is to reach 10 million kids across the developing world with the lifelong gift of education. That means bringing 10 million kids access to schools, to books, to bilingual libraries, and to scholarships. So we're going to take a very, very good run at this. I'll tell you in the 8 minutes I have left how we're doing tracking against that goal. Really, if you look at the developing world today where we're working, we face three grand challenges, one of which is getting this remote control to work. Where is the projector? You can always blame Microsoft when stuff like this happens. And even if they had nothing to do with the machine, people will still like give you the benefit of the doubt. So there's three main challenges we're going after in the developing world today. And these are the statistics that I think are fairly shocking, that we live in a time of great affluence around the world. And here are the three statistics that really, for me, make me wake up and go work long hours every single day, 7 days a week. Number one, 110 million kids of primary school age are not enrolled in school. Think about that, these children age 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 years old who wake up every day. And this morning, 110 million little kids around the developing world woke up and they did not put on a school uniform, they did not grab their backpack, they did not walk to school, and they did not learn. And to me, that's just wrong, and we have to do something about it, and we have to do something about it starting immediately. The second statistic is that 800 million people in the developing world, and this is one out of every seven human beings, cannot read or write. They just face basic illiteracy. So of course, if you are illiterate, you're fighting the war against poverty with one hand tied behind your back. And then the big statistic that I think is probably a big concern of this school and to the girls who are in school here is that two-thirds of both these groups are girls and women. Girls and women bear the disproportionate brunt of the problem of lack of educational opportunities. This is, to me, a tragedy, because if you go to a place like Cambodia, the ratio of boys to girls in secondary school is 3-1. I believe the ratio of boys to girls should be 1-1. And we can't stop till we get there, because that is just an issue of basic equity, an issue of basic morality, and it's also a question of, do we want to educate the next generation and the next and the next? All of us, of course, are the products of educated mothers and educated fathers. So paying that gift forward to these kids throughout the developing world is a big thing to be able to do. Many of you know where we work. We're working in some of the poorest countries in the world. 84% of the kids not enrolled in school are in this swath of sub-Saharan Africa, the Middle East, South and Southeast Asia. In the Arab world, 50% of women are illiterate. In sub-Saharan Africa, only 1 of 5 girls even starts 6th grade. So we have our work cut out for us, we have a lot to do. But thankfully we're making great, great progress. I know your goal here is to raise money for at least 100 girls to have a scholarship for a year. And I want to talk to you in closing about some of the students we're helping to bring these stories home to you so you can see what you are doing and who you are helping. This shot is from Vietnam, taken this summer. It is in the Mekong Delta. We did a trip where we actually opened a number of new schools and a number of new libraries. This was a very special visit because the kids, just as you're going to have a dance performance here tonight, we had a dance performance with the kids in this small town in Vietnam, welcoming us with their dragon costumes and their dancing. And we were cutting the red ribbon on this amazing new library. These were the, we called them the cheerleaders. They were cheering for literacy. And these were students actually from Lakeside High School in Seattle. Julian Schott and Alex Nordstrom, who had done a big fundraising event at their school up in Seattle. And they were cutting the red ribbon. But to me, what was most exciting on this day was this kid, this 15-year-old kid who came up to me, and we were walking out of the library, and he came up to me and he said, "Hello, Mr. John Wood, I wish to thank you for our school's library." He said, "I love to read books. I love to read books in Vietnamese. I love to read books in English. My goal is to read every single book in this library." And I thought about that and like what impact that has on a kid who a month ago didn't have a library and now he does. And what does that mean? That means he actually has a chance to improve his mind and become a lifelong learner. This is a shot from India that one of my teammates took when he was in India last year. He came back and showed me this picture and I said to him, "Jason, why are these little girls so happy? What's their story?" And he said, "Oh, these are the orphans. These are the orphans in the Munir orphanage." And I knew the story of this orphanage. These girls all lost their parents in a fire that swept through a slum. The slums in India have open flames. They certainly do not have much water, and they do not have a fire department. All these girls lost their parents in the fire, and the orphanage where they ended up could not afford to send them to school. They petitioned Ms. Sunisha, our country director in India. The orphanage asked, "Can Room to Read sponsor these girls on scholarship?" You look at them now with the hope they have and the smiles in their faces, and that's what change all of you are creating to get these girls into school. It doesn't cost much. It's $250 per girl per year. It is a drop in the bucket, and it is a long-term solution at the same time. And then finally, I just want to show you a story, a picture of one of our newest authors. We actually author and publish children's books throughout the developing world in languages that have never had children's books before because the parents can't afford books, so the publishers don't publish. And in this case, here is a shot of one of our authors. We now have a number of young girls who are publishing children's books through Room to Read. This little girl in Sri Lanka wrote a book called Baby Fish Goes to School. And it is a story of a little fish who wakes up every morning and doesn't get to go to school. And it cries that it can't go to school and asks its mother, why? And the mother says, "Well, the school is on land. And you're a fish. Tough luck." And the little fish is bummed out, and then one day all the other animals, and the animals are led by Mr. Tiger, because tigers are clever, the animals go out and the animals buy a fishbowl. And they go and they scoop up baby fish, and they have a parade, and they plunk baby fish down next to the chalkboard, and voila, baby fish goes to school. I told that story at the Clinton Global Initiative while speaking this year, and I looked out in the audience and I was like, oh my God, Toni Morrison is crying. That is beautiful. Literally, I'm not making this up. Toni Morrison was crying here, and I thought, here's a 10-year-old Sri Lankan girl who could be the Toni Morrison of Sri Lanka. Who knows? Let's try to give her a chance and see what happens. Finally, the parents, so involved in the projects we're doing around the world. We believe that you can only help people if they want to help themselves. So the parents are enlisted to help construct the libraries. The parents are enlisted to help build the schools. This is a village in Nepal where I watch the mothers wake up before sunrise and walk an hour and a half down a steep mountainside to put 110-pound bags of cement on their backs. And the mothers then walked 2 hours back uphill. And I don't think most of these mothers weighed 110 pounds. But they took the 50-kilo bags of cement and brought them up to their village because they wanted their daughters and their sons to have education. We call it the Challenge Grant. What it basically means is we'll partner with the community. We will not do it for them. We will do it with them in partnership. This is a shot from Laos, one of the poorest countries in Asia, a groundbreaking ceremony. The biggest problem we had on this day is we ran out of shovels. The parents turned out in droves to help to do the groundbreaking ceremony. Finally, another one of our school stories is a school here called Benegat School. This school was dedicated by Hillary Valentine, who lives in Woodside, in honor of her parents, Don and Rachel Valentine. And we went to the school opening in 2002. And in 2007, I got this photo from one of my team who was traveling through Nepal, and they said, send Hillary this photo of her school. Except this was not the photo that they sent me. This was the photo they sent me. And I sent it to my country director and said, what happened to the Benegat school? How did it double in size? And he said, well, they had twice as many students show up as expected. And I said, well, do they need money? And he said, no, the parents told us they were really proud that we helped them with the first time around. This time they're going to do everything on their own. So that's the level of commitment you get when the parents have picked up the shovels and dug the foundation. They believe in education. They believe in getting their kids into school. I want to close just with a couple of statistics. We talk a lot at Room to Read about going to scale. As I said, we live in an era of great ambition here in Silicon Valley. Nobody's afraid to think very, very big. What we're trying to do is think equally big about education in the developing world. So how are we doing at scaling? Well, I wanted to show you a couple shots of our schools. We have, in 7 years, we've opened 447 schools across the developing world. This year alone, we are opening 250 schools across the developing world. It is 5 new schools opening per week on average. Every one of them has a story. Every one of them is a dedication plaque, because every one of these schools can be endowed. And it can be a sister school relationship. It can be an honor of parents. My friend Paul Stephenson, who's a banker with UBS in Singapore, went home one night and told his wife, good news, honey, for our 25th anniversary. I'm not buying you a diamond. I'm building you a school in Nepal. And she said, better news, honey, I've seen the tax return. You're doing both. So in addition to the diamond, she now has her school. But we'll be at about 700 schools by the end of this year, our 8th full year of operations. We now have over 4,000 little girls on long-term scholarships. Each one of these girls has been guaranteed that she will have her scholarship renewed. Through the end of secondary school, we pay their school fees, bicycles, school uniforms, their school supplies, their health care, their mentoring, their after-school tutoring, but most importantly, the ridiculously oversized Room to Read backpack. We have very big ambitions for these girls. And there will be no need to upgrade to version 2.0 of the backpack. Finally, our library program has really gone to scale. The whole idea in 1998 I had was to help one school in Bahundanda, Nepal, have its first library. In December of last year, we opened our 5,000th school library. And we announced at that same time that we were going to double down and go to over 10,000 libraries by the end of 2010. We believe that by the end of 2010, 5 million students across the developing world will have access to our bilingual libraries with content in their own language plus content in English. So we're very, very, very excited about that. I'm going to close just with one quick growth comparison about what we're doing, how quickly we're trying to get out and reach the developing world. You may be asking yourself, well, that's a great growth rate, but how does it compare to the world leader in growth of new outlets? And so what I want to show you here is a growth comparison of Starbucks post-initial public offering of stock, new outlets each and every year, compared to Room to Read and the green of new libraries. And what you see is in the first couple of years, they're kind of... And I'd like to posit that our quality is just as high. Because we're putting in local language books, we're doing monitoring evaluation, we're training the librarians, we're going back and making sure things are working month after month after month after month. This year, 2,000 new libraries will be open. It means one new library every 6 hours opening somewhere in the developing world. It means between the time you eat lunch and the time you eat dinner, we're going to open a new library. Between the time you go to sleep and the time you wake up, we're going to open a new library. Between the time you get on a plane in New York and you land in San Francisco, we're going to open a new library. Between the time I boarded my last American Airlines flight and the time it actually took off, my team had actually opened a new library. I'm not going to go on this statistic long. It speaks for itself. This is our overhead ratio. We do whatever we can to keep our expenses low. We're about 1/3 of the charitable average in the U.S. So when you do give to Room to Read, the money is going where it's most needed to the programs, not to the fundraising team. To date, in about 8 years, we've reached 1.7 million children across the developing world. We have a long ways to go to reach 10 million, but it's a very, very nice start. Every day, 1.7 million kids wake up and have access to a Room to Read school, library, or scholarship. So thank you, everybody, for supporting us. I close with this question because I think we live in times that can be optimistic, and then we live in times that can at the same time be pessimistic. Looking at the world today, Afghanistan, Iraq, the Middle East, there are a lot of problems out there. But I think that education is inherently an optimistic thing. When you see a school like this one in the Mekong Delta opening, and the kids in their uniforms doing their morning calisthenics, that to me is about optimism, self-sufficiency, and these kids having a chance to get out of poverty forever. So thank you for supporting Room to Read, and I'm gonna close with one final thought. Thank you very much.
Such a brimming measure of romance and beauty coupled with utility as does aviation.
Weapons, but also in its geography. It is warfare in terms of every continent, every island, every sea, every air lane in the world. That is the reason why I have asked you to take out and spread before you a map of the whole earth, and to follow me in the references which I shall make to the world encircling battle lines of this war.
Seeing you in all the old familiar. shine. She's a part of the assembly line. She's making history, working for victory. Rosie, the riveter, takes a sharp look out for sabotage. Sitting up there on the fuselage, that little friend who more than the man that knew. Rosie, the riveter, Rosie can't afford friend Charlie. Charlie, he's a Marine. Rosie is protecting Charlie, working overtime on the riveting machine. When they gave her a production lead, she was as proud as a girl could be. There's something true about red, white, and blue about Rosie, the riveter.
Like a hammer, and I stutter and I stammer every time I see you at the picture show. I guess I'm just another fan of yours, and I thought I'd write and tell you so.
Didn't wanna do it. You made me love. A year.
The course we are following is the best course. I have therefore considered it essential to relieve General MacArthur so that there would be no doubt or confusion as to the real purpose and aim of our policy.
Don't hold back.
The first artificial Earth satellite in the world has now been created.
Thank you. thinks that I am one, forgettables too.
Rock. 5, 6, 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock, rock. to witness the excitement stirred by these youngsters from Liverpool who call themselves the people. Now tonight, you're going to twice be entertained by them. Right now, and again in the second half of our show, ladies and gentlemen, the Beatles.
When your energy's broken and you thirst for something cold, this is it, Pepsi-Cola.
It's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
Can do for you, ask what you can do for your country.
I'm not afraid to You know that I would be a liar if I was to say it to you. Girl, we couldn't get much higher.
Just mad about